Alrighty, welcome back to the Morning Drill. 6 minutes past the hour of 8 o'clock. And joining us this morning from Titusville Area Hospital, it's Mary Ellen Payton. Good morning. How are you today?
Great, thank you.
Thank you for joining us.
Thanks.
Well, you should be excited. The sun's
I know, the sun is nice.
Yeah, we were just talking about that.
Well, it's one of those things where, it kind of catches you off guard a little bit. You do a double take and you're... That is the sun.
That
it
is
does
the sun,
exist.
And it better stay out until 5 o'clock.
Well, first of all, how are you?
I'm great, thank you.
It's great to see you. Now, you're here today to tell us about something going on this week.
Yes, it's actually Laboratory Professional Week. Yay. Nationwide, yes.
Very nice. Before we get into that, though, let's learn a little bit about who you are.
Okay. I'm Mary Ellen Tempest, or Payton, actually. Tempest was my maiden name. I'm going way back. I actually was hired at Titusville Hospital as a temporary employee. I don't want to say how long ago. It was a really long time. And I have been part-time, full-time, have done just about every job that there is to have in the lab. And about 15 years ago, I was asked to take the job as the manager of the lab. So it's been a wonderful career. And I think it speaks for the remainder of the staff that we have at the lab, because many people have been there their entire career.
So tell us a little bit about what happens at the lab and then what your roles are.
Okay. We have about six different actual departments. We have a blood bank, and we actually prepare a patient's specimen to receive the best type of blood that if they need to have blood. We do screenings to make sure that there isn't anything that would make them receiving a unit of blood hazardous to them. Oh. So we do a lot. We call that a cross match. A lot of people are on heparin, Coumadin, and we test them to make sure that the medication that they take is not too high and would cause them to bleed, or they're too low and they could form clots. We do testing for mononucleosis, arthritis, pregnancy in that department.
Wow.
Microbiology, we do all kinds of specimens to grow the bacteria so you know what's actually making you sick. Then we determine the best antibiotic for you. We do flu testing, different viral testing. Then we have chemistry, and we have two instruments that run all day long, 24 hours a day. We do probably about 60 to 70 different tests on those two instruments.
Wow.
We have a hematology department where we do blood counts. So that's going to tell you if you have a high white, like if you have an infection, if you have leukemia, lymphoma. So we look at white cells to determine is it bacterial, is it viral, and help the doctor in that way. We have a processing department where all the specimens that come in to the lab are directed to the right area. We do a lot of outreach. We have two locations in Oil City, the Glenview Building and in Seneca, where we actually have someone collecting specimens in those sites along with Tynesta Health Center.
Wow.
So about 4:30, we get a tremendous load of specimens coming into the lab, and then they are processed and taken to the different departments. We also draw arterial blood so that we can tell the doctor how much oxygen or the pH of a blood that the patient has so that they can treat them appropriately. So
it's Sounds like a very, very important area of the hospital that...
It is. We do almost 700,000 tests a year.
That's incredible.
And my budget is over, it's almost $1.1 million to run the department. In Little Titusville.
Wow.
What's changed over the years? I mean, if you were to go back, you know, 20 years, I mean, how has that department changed?
The automation. We can now, when a patient is drawn, we immediately, while they're still sitting there, put a label that has been printed that has a barcode on it. That barcode is going to identify the patient by name, their age, identification, what tests they have to have. So then we can proceed to put that tube on the instrument and knows exactly what to do.
That's incredible. Mm-hmm. Where do you see things going into the future?
A lot more, they call it polymerase chain reaction testing. It's the newer methods that are going to be much more specific as far as heart testing, heart damage testing. It'll be big there.
Wow.
How do you find out about all of this? I imagine there's probably a level of education that has to continually happen.
We have education every year. All the staff has to have 12 credits of education. And the companies that we buy our instruments, they provide a lot of education material and keeps us up to date.
So,
and we all subscribe to numerous magazines that have articles about the newest testing.
So a little bit more than the Sally Struthers School of, okay, which is how I got mine.
Mm-hmm, sure. Yeah, all the technologists have a Bachelor of Science degree, and then we have a year of training at a hospital that is a teaching facility for the clinic, and it's a clinical laboratory science degree.
That's incredible. Well, let's talk about some of the folks who are up there.
Okay.
Who's up there and what sort of roles do they have?
We have Lana Lyle in hematology. Steve Kowalsik kind of directs the chemistry. Pat Brown is microbiology. Lori Owen is processing. Jane Lee is blood bank. Karen Walmark is pathology. And then we have numerous phlebotomists who are, I mean, they are our key people. They're the people who the patients see.
And that's really important, isn't it?
Oh, it's huge. It's huge.
A lot of times you'll get somebody up there who's kind of scared. Maybe they don't like needles or...
We get them.
Yeah.
I'm surprised. I mean, even as adults, you know, and I am, it's heartwarming to see the compassion that these people, they show these patients. We get very involved with our patients, and for some people, the elderly, it might be their social outing for the day is to come and have their blood drawn.
And we all have bad days.
Sure.
But I know the folks up there, you can't tell if they're having a bad day, because they always have a smile. They're always patient and caring with the individual. And I think part of it is realizing that this person might be scared because they don't know what's going on. Mm-hmm. So there's a little bit of, there's a lot of compassion up there then.
We actually, we depend a lot upon patient satisfaction. And we always do very well. It's very seldom that I hear a complaint. And it's... You know, it might be someone who was really hard to get their blood, but for the most part, we do very, very well. And it has a lot to say about how the whole staff feels about the patients. I mean, we diagnose some really awful things, and 90% of the decisions that a physician will make depends upon the results that we give them.
How do you deal with that? I mean, that must be an awful responsibility.
It is horrible.
Especially in a small town where you know a lot of people.
We do, but we have to kind of remove ourselves from that and focus, you know, on what we're doing, making sure that what we are telling that doctor is correct. And it breaks our hearts. We've had patients that we maybe monitor their chemotherapy through the blood tests, and I mean it breaks our hearts to see them going in a wrong direction, that it's not working, or it makes us very happy when we see good things happening.
So getting back to what this week means, tell us a little bit about the week itself.
Okay. We have to focus on what the close tie is between what we do and the diagnosis that we make. And we want the best possible patient outcome. So we're serious about that. And we focus upon that this week, you know, that we are doing a very good job and that we are very professional. And that it's kind of like, thank you very much for the job that you do, the job that you do well. And we had a pizza party yesterday. We have door prizes, different things.
We didn't get invited to the pizza party.
No, you didn't.
Next time you'll have to have enough to share, I guess.
Yeah.
When it comes to getting the message out about what you do and getting interest from students, mm-hmm. or do you guys go to career fairs, or how do you recruit students?
We don't. Actually, we've had several students who have reached their degree and they can't find work.
Wow.
Which is, it's really sad. And they're very bright. So we have actually, they've come in and they shadow us for a day or two. And they immediately make up their mind that this is what they want to do. I mean, it's very exciting. And they have to meet all the criteria for the basics and then do that last year in the hospital. That's where you really get hands-on and learn what we do.
And it seems like in your area, every day would be different.
Sure.
Or in a smaller hospital, say, they would have, I guess, a little bit of everything to deal with.
Yes.
So,
like especially like the 3-11 shift or the 11-7 shift. It's limited staff. You don't have all those people working in all the in one area. So the 3-11 and the 11-7 shift staff need to know how to do everything.
I would think that would be excellent training.
It is. It's frightening that first night that you do because you don't know what's gonna come down. But it's very exciting. But we were also aligned with Fortis Institute in Erie, and we took their students and allowed them to actually do that clinical portion. And Fortis has a different program where the students are actually a 2-year program instead of the 4-year like the technologists.
Oh, wow.
So it was a 20-week program, and they came every day and worked alongside of us and learned how to do the tests. And then they were given tests, and we have hired 2 of them.
So in terms of experience at the lab, what's sort of the range in terms of experience, I guess? I mean, you mentioned that some of the folks who've been up there. How long have they been with the hospital? Do you know?
Oh, my. I would say the most senior is approaching, there's several of us, approaching 35 years, and the least senior is probably 3.
So you started at 5?
I started at 5, that's right.
Okay.
Very smart
Thank
child.
You. So, really, I mean, folks in the community are very fortunate to have the experience and the talent right here in the community.
They really are. They really are. And, you know, I need to speak of the, you know, going back to Lab Week, the dedication that these people show to these patients without even thinking about it. I mean, how many young, newly graduating college students do you think would go into a job that they know they're going to work nights, they're going to work weekends, they're going to work holidays, they may get called in, they may need to work overtime? Probably not very many. These people do it without even blinking an eye.
And I'm sure that just because your shift says, say, 9 to 5, folks know that when 5 o'clock hits, that doesn't mean you're walking out the door.
Most of the time, the way we have it organized, yes, it can happen. But there are times when there may be something emergent going on and they don't get out.
Yeah. Well, and I think that goes back to the caring. As they get to know these patients, and sure, as the doctor says, hey, you know, Mrs. So-and-so, we really need to check this to make a decision.
Mm-hmm.
Folks don't mind putting a few extra minutes in just to make sure that, you know, that information gets to the doctor.
That's right.
So
that's right. And that is a whole process in itself with our computer system. You know, the reports print and the organization that we need to have in that aspect. It's a job in itself to make sure that that happens. And when you asked about new things that are happening, it's one of the things is electronic medical records, that when we are completed with, like, say, your test, and we verify, we've checked the results, we verify it, it will then go to your physician through electronic medical records.
Wow.
Rather than it. Currently, we're printing a paper copy, and for most offices right now, they get the paper. But very soon it will all be electronic.
That's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when you talk about certain things that happen, I mean, every second counts in a lot of cases. So mm-hmm. the moment you get those results, to be able to just have that automatically in the system, and then, you know, the doctor picks up the iPad and there it is,
yes,
or their phone, and
yes,
say, oh, here's the results. I mean, every second counts.
It does, and we have a whole system for values that we recover that are, say, critical values, call values, that we have to act upon that, and I have to monitor that every day, that is happening, that doctor is called.
Wow.
And properly documented. So we do, we're also, in order to be paid for from government agencies like Medicaid, Medicare, and insurers. I mean, in order to have our license, we have to be able to prove that we are doing every test correct. So we're held accountable. So we do about 2,500 tests on top of patient tests that we are graded upon. And for the grading facility, we have to have an 80% in order to continue to have our license.
Wow.
However, we are under the umbrella of the Pennsylvania Department of Health. They require 100%.
Really?
Mm-hmm. So we have to pass those tests. So that's another mechanism that we have in place, that we know we are doing everything correctly.
Wow. I mean, we need that accountability here.
That's just a little bit of pressure, isn't
well,
it?
Well, on top of that, then we have every day, for every test we do, we run between 2 and 3 samples that are not patients, and they have to fall within a certain range. So we're constantly checking ourselves to make sure that those results are correct.
Well, that's incredible.
Yeah. There's a lot to do.
Well, this tells you what a good job you guys are doing.
We are. So, I said about the offices. We are going to have a health fair coming up in Tynesta on May 21st, I believe. And so this gives people an opportunity that maybe they don't have insurance, that they can have a lot of testing done, a screening, for about $45.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is a good deal.
Mm-hmm.
How long does something like that take? Like, do they come in and you just draw blood and out they go? Should somebody budget a time of a half hour or an hour or a couple hours?
I would say if they planned on a half an hour, by the time they gave their information, came to the table, the lab table, had their blood drawn easily. But they have to make an appointment.
Okay. And they can call you, or do they call over?
They call to the Tynesta Health Center.
Okay. Do you have the number?
755-3634.
755-3634.
Or call the hospital switchboard and they'll
wait. Okay. Or you can contact the hospital switchboard and they'll connect you over to the folks in Tynesta. And again, that's the Tynesta Health Fair coming up May 21st. So this is what you do on the 21st. You go and vote and you go get checked.
Good
for $45
idea.
Bucks, and you get a lot of testing done for that amount.
I would say that the testing that we do would probably run about $125, and you're getting it for $45.
How much of it, though, is somebody afraid to get those results? Maybe they have a history of something, and to them, they're just stubborn, and they don't want to know, and they should.
Exactly, and you bring up a good point. I think that might be what it is, or some people just don't want to have their blood. I have heard the figure of 60% of the patients, that a doctor gives them a slip, paper, to have lab testing done. Maybe it's X-ray also. They never have it done. Whether it's finances, lack of insurance, co-pays, but yeah, it's so.
Or just being afraid to know what the answer is.
It could be. Most of the time, we find very little alarming results with these fares.
So. Now they'll have the blood work done there, and then they get shipped here for the testing, or will they be tested?
The blood will come to the hospital. We'll test it. It'll be done the same day.
Okay. And that is 755-3631 to call and get that scheduled. Okay. 755-3631. Now let's kind of touch upon nutrition and wellness classes.
Okay. I also teach a loose 10 and 10 class, and we work with Highmark and the classes, there are actually people that we teach them portion size. They really focus on the size of your plate, how much should be protein, vegetables, starch, fruit. Encourage people to drink lots of water, stay away from desserts, and really focus on good nutrition. I've had in the class that have done so well. I mean, they've never had someone tell them, use a small plate. I think your meat is a quarter, your starch is a quarter, half your plate should be a vegetable, a salad, and have a fruit, and incorporating a lot of protein in fruits.
Ooh, see, I don't mind the smaller plate. It's just it's hard to stack everything up, and that's. That's my issue.
Yes.
But it's easier said than done. I mean, if you can get somebody who can attempt to do this, stay with it, the success rates are.
And many of the people in the classes don't exercise, don't walk, they don't do anything. So it's a really good class.
Well, today it seems like people are looking for quick, easy ways
sure.
to lose weight or to figure out any sort of health issue, and that's not the case. You have to work at it. The best way is to actually get up and move, watch what you eat. And now, if they want to enroll in a class or get more information, do they contact the hospital? Do they reach you?
Do you know?
Community relations.
Okay. Everything goes through community relations. Boy, it sounds like you're just involved with a lot of things.
A lot of things.
Yeah. Now, before you go,
yes.
One of the things we didn't get to involving your personal life, your kids. You've got wonderful kids.
I do. I have two children, Joe and Rose, and I have four of the most adorable grandchildren you could ever have.
Well, I've known them both for a while, and
yes.
I just saw Rose a couple weeks ago. She looks great. She big smile on her face.
As always.
Yeah. She's doing well. She's teaching?
She teaches reading in the Sagertown School District. And she has, she's also certified to teach art. And that was her first love as far as her education. And I'm hoping that she will continue that.
Very good. Well, it's great seeing you.
Thank
Congratulations
you.
With
Thank
everything.
You. Thank
and
you.
This is a big week. So stop on up. And can folks pop in and just say, hey,
they sure can.
Congratulations.
They can say thank you to their phlebotomist. You did a good job. They would like that very much.
Well, very good. I hope folks do. We've had a few situations where we've been up at the hospital, and your results have been very, very important. So
they are.
We greatly appreciate the patience you guys have, and just the care and the love that everybody has up there. So.
Thank you.
Keep up the good work.
Thanks.
All righty. And for the Tynesta Health Fair, you can call 755-3631. You can call 827-1851 as well. Reach the switchboard. And also for the wellness, you can call Community Relations to get that information. So
that's right.
Drop 10 and 10.
Drop 10 and 10 and eat well for life.
I need to drop 20. We'll work on that plan. 20. I got to drop 20.
Okay.
All righty. Thank you very much. All right, Mary Ellen Payton joining us here this morning.
We'll see ya. Thank you for coming.
8:35 is our time. We're going to talk to Paula Lynch, and we also have Mike Thomas joining us when the morning drill continues right after this.